sleep.
December 14th, December 14th, 1995. Interview with Aniko Friedberg, Nee Weiss. Interviewer Tina Tito. We are in Huntington, New York, in the USA. The interview will be conducted in English. Today is December 14th, 1995. I am Tina Tito, the interviewer. I will be interviewing Aniko Friedberg. We are in Huntington, New York. Mrs. Friedberg, could you please tell us your full name and spell it for us?
My last name is Friedberg, F as in Frank, R-I-E-D-B-E-R-G. My first name is Aniko, A-N-I-K-O.
And you were born?
I was, my name at birth was Weiss Aniko, Weiss, W-E-I-S-Z.
And later on it changed?
And my father changed his name from Weiss to Veres, V-E-R-E-S. So
why did he change his name?
It was very customary in Hungary, especially, I guess, among more assimilated Jews. It was called, like, Hungarianizing the name. I guess it wasn't a denial of being Jewish. There was no question about that anyway in the town where we lived. It was probably because we did feel Hungarian, and also must have been an economical advantage. You know, if there were several people applying for a job, which wasn't the case for my father, but the one who had a Hungarian-sounding name would come before any other.
Where were you born?
I was born in Debrecen, D-E-B-R-E-C-E-N, which was the second largest city at that time in Hungary, university town.
And when were you born?
October 16, 1928.
And tell me about your father, his full name.
His last name was like mine, Veres, before that, born Weiss. And his first name was Ferenc, F-E-R-E-N-C.
Mm-hmm. What did he do?
He was a mechanical engineer and a businessman as well. And as an engineer, he was also an inventor. Many of his inventions were really put to use, and they are still being used in Hungary and other parts.
Please tell us about
world.
An invention that you were aware of.
Well, I remember he had inventions around the clock, practically. It was just, for me, I thought this is the way people are, or men or fathers are, the way he was going from one room to the other. He devised a better way to get there. And really, people used to compare him, they said he was like a Hungarian Edison. And up to the last maybe month up to his death, he had inventions that were put to use by the Hungarian communist government. He died in 1970.
And in terms of your style of living in Hungary before the
pre-war. It was an idyllic childhood, and I just remember only good and warm and nice and safe and secure, and thinking that my parents are wonderful and all grown-ups must be just like this, and the future can only bring wonderful things. We had a very comfortable life, and we lived in a nice apartment, and I went to school, and my parents loved each other, and they loved me.
Where did your father come from originally?
He was born in a part of Hungary, which became subsequently the part of Czechoslovakia, and then Hungary again. It went back and forth in the northern part of Hungary. I think now it's part of the Ukraine. But he was a small child when they moved from there, and they moved a part of Hungary which became Romania after a while, and then his parents had a large mill and a farm, a steam mill and a farm. And when he was quite young, he volunteered or ran away and joined the Hungarian army in World War I, where he became an officer and had all kinds of decorations. And when the war ended, he went to France. and he lived there for a while. Well, no, first he went to Germany, and then he went to France.
Where did he get his education?
Well, he had his high school education in Hungary, and then he went to Berlin, and he studied at the Technische Hochschule in Germany, and then he went to Paris, and he studied in Paris, and then he stayed there for a few years, and he just came back for a visit, a family visit, when he met my mother in Hungary, and they...
How did they meet?
I really don't know, except that my mother was such a beautiful, beautiful woman, and anybody who met her, I guess, just wanted her for more than just a short time, and it was love right away.
What was your mother's full name?
Her last name was Benedek, born Benedek, B-E-N-E-D-E-K, and her first name was Ilona, and my father and all her friends called her Ilush or Ilushka.
And did she come from Debrecen?
She was from Budapest. That's where they met. My grandparents lived in Budapest. And they just moved to Debrecen. Again, it's not quite clear to me why, but it had something to do with opportunity, I guess. And that's where we lived up to the time we were deported from there.
Did your mother have any profession?
My mother was a what you would call a housewife, no profession. But she, I am reluctant to say this because she was certainly anything but a what you would call a lady of leisure, because she was always busy, always doing something creative, charitable, industrious.
Fully integrated into the Hungarian environment or with Jewish causes?
Well, Both. It was these two things were not contradictory at all. We were Hungarian Jews, and she was going to a Jewish soup kitchen all the time, regularly, at least once a week. Serving lunch to children. But and we had the Kerem Kayemet. I guess you call it the pushki, all kinds of things like that. But just there was no division between being Hungarian and being Jewish.
So in terms of your household, were you a kosher household?
No.
Did you celebrate Shabbat at home?
Well, my mother did light candles Friday night, but somehow we did not celebrate Shabbat. Reasons for lighting candles Friday night were mainly because of remembering her father who died, and then the way more and more family members and acquaintances died, she would add a candle. I remember that very well. And she lit the candle and she covered her head and she said her prayers.
And do you remember any holidays, Jewish holidays that were spent at home or with family?
Well, Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur were definitely the major holidays when we all went to the synagogue. Debrecen had a very beautiful synagogue, and it was a neologue. There were Orthodox and neologue were the two denominations. And nevertheless, it was a neologue synagogue. The women sat upstairs and the men downstairs.
And you went there twice a year, as you remember?
Definitely twice a year, I remember. Now, my parents might have gone, to say the prayer for their deceased ones. I have never gone other days than that.
And do you remember the name of the synagogue?
No, I don't think it had a name. It was the only synagogue, only neologue synagogue in Debrecen, and it was really a beautiful landmark building. We were very proud of it. And not only Jews, all people in Debrecen regarded it as a beautiful building with a beautiful garden. And so when the parents went there, even on the major holidays, the children played in the garden.
Mm-hmm. And school, did you go to public school?
I went to Jewish grade school 4 years, and after that I went to a Roman Catholic convent school, which was a gymnasium. And the reason for this was that there was one excellent Jewish gymnasium in Debrecen for boys only. There were no girls allowed. And so the only way for a girl to be able to go on and get a university education was to go to a gymnasium. So I wasn't the only Jewish girl. In every class, there were about four or five Jewish girls.
What was the name of the Roman Catholic
school?
Gymnasium?
The Svetic. It was called the Svetic by the founders of the school.
How did they accommodate your Jewishness in the school?
I was very aware all the time, but there was no conflict. Nobody ever tried to make me feel bad. Excuse me. Whenever there was a Catholic religious instruction, we always went out. We had a free hour. We had a special room where the Jewish girls stayed, and I sculpted, or the others read, and you know, we had a nice quiet hour. And then we went back. So there was a distinction over. Sometimes the girls came, the other girls came from church first thing in the morning, and they had their breakfast after that. But we already had our breakfast at home. You know, there were little differences.
You played, though, with other children?
We played, and we were friends in school, and we liked each other and helped each other just the same. However, after school, we didn't socialize. All my friends were Jewish girls, and I was never invited to any of my classmates' homes.
And you didn't invite them back to yours?
No. Never even, you know, we met on the street, we said a friendly hello, but that was it.
Where did you live in Debrecen? Do you remember the address?
Well, it was called the Bika Beerhaus. Orange Bika means golden bull. It's still there. It's one of the most famous buildings, I guess, in Debrecen. It's a big hotel that has an apartment building attached to it. And that's where I lived until they have taken us away.
Describe your room.
The room in our apartment? Well, actually, it was still more like what we called a children's room. I remember it had painted furniture. And since my mother was always, as I said, she was creative, not like an artist, and she probably didn't even know that she was creative. She just was. She always repainted everything, you know, from your dresses to the walls to the furniture. Everything was always redone. She had an idea. So I guess I must have had pink and blue and all these traditional colors. But then when I remembered that, suddenly she realized that it would be much nicer to have yellow, a bright yellow with a little red trim. And then she got matching lovely yellow and red flowered curtains, that the whole room will look like the sun was always shining in. And I never questioned. I just thought she did everything wonderfully, and I was very proud of having such a sunny room. However, I also remember toward the very end she was planning to redo the room, because I was getting to be a big girl and I shouldn't have a children's room, and she was planning to change the bed to something more, you know, more sophisticated. And it never really happened, but I remember the preparations, the thoughts.
Did she ever make clothes for you?
She designed the clothes and she bought the fabrics, and she also always had some great idea. But like everybody in those days in Hungary, or almost everybody, bought the fabric, and they had a little dressmaker who would then sew it up.
Now, in the building that you lived in, was it a mixed building with Jews and non-Jews living in the building?
It was mixed.
Friendly?
Very friendly.
In each other's houses?
It was a large apartment building, and it wasn't very common that Jews and Christians socialized. However, almost every Jewish family had a Christian friend, and vice versa. Actually, it was said later on, sort of facetiously, when anti-Semitism started to show its ugly head, that you know, the Jews are so terrible and all kinds of terrible things about Jews. Yet every Christian, every anti-Semite would have a favorite Jew. And every anti-Semite would have a Jew about who would say, oh, Mr. Weiss, you're not like the others. You know, so if you would add up all these Jews, that it turned out that they were all not like the others. So we had in the same building, there was also a couple with whom they would get together, and they had a daughter who was maybe 2 years older than I, with whom I would play. Until the Germans came in, which was the last in 1944, March, then after all this stopped.
But you physically or emotionally never felt terribly different about being a Jew in Hungary?
I did feel different, but I never verbalized it. I just knew it. I remember maybe a few instances that I was very disturbed. For example, in school, they really liked my mother because she would come and get me, and the nun always said, "What a nice mother I have!" You know, she had a nice interested in me, a nice conversation. And once my father came to school for some reason to pick me up, which he never did. And he was a very handsome, tall man. And next day they told me that, oh, we saw your father. He looks like a Hungarian man. He's so nice. He looks just like a Hungarian man. And I remember, I don't even think I mentioned this to my parents. I thought it was so strange. Well, he is a Hungarian man. That why did they think that it's so strange that he looked like one? So they had this stereotype, I guess.
And in your community, the stores, were they Jewish owners, Christian owners? Was there a specific Jewish area?
Well, in Hungary, there were either very assimilated Jews or there were the Jews who lived in a sort of a ghetto, in a self-designated ghetto area, and there was really quite a big difference between the two both in by not socializing, because the very Orthodox Jews would not even consider talking to us, and I guess it was really a very strong demarcation. And the assimilated Jews were very Hungarian, and besides we spoke Hungarian at home, we also spoke German at home, which was a second language in Hungary, tradition from the Hungarian, Austro-Hungarian monarchy days. Plus, I also had an Austrian nanny who was there ever since I was born. And the idea behind this was just to bring you up bilingual. And so it was part of the proper education upbringing for a middle-class girl, I guess.
Did you have special things that your parents brought you to? Piano lessons, ballet?
Constantly. The life was just running from one lesson to the other for me and my friends. You know, we had school six days a week. There you have your Shabbat answer right away. Even though I remember I had a girlfriend, a classmate who was an Orthodox girl, and she would come to school on Saturday and never write. Did I envy her, you know, because we would have a big test sometimes and she was excused not to do it. And they respected her for that. There was no problem. And I'm sorry, I get sidetracked all the time.
No, that's okay. I'm asking about the activities you did after school.
Oh, yes. So that was 6 days a week, and then we would go home for lunch. That was the big meal of the day, was lunch anyway. My father came home, and we sat down to the table. I was an only child, and that was about 2 o'clock lunch. And right after that, I had to do my homework. We had a lot of homework, and that would be maybe an hour, and then I would go to piano lesson, to ballet lesson, to what other lessons? I don't remember. I took English lessons. I took French lessons. So that was just the way of life for me.
Also, you said you were interested in drama.
Well, I was mainly Yes, I was interested in drama only because I loved poetry, and I used to like to recite poetry, which is a very respectable thing in Hungary, unlike in America, to be a poet or poetry are very much part of Hungarian culture. And so you learn to tell poems the way you learn to talk. You know, like by the time I was 2 or 2 and a half, they would put me on top of a table and I would recite a small poem. And I'm still, my head and heart is still full. I know hundreds of Hungarian poems by heart. And so that was it. But my main interest was always art, painting and sculpture. Ever since I was 5 years old, I remember doing it.
Formal lessons?
Not at that age. I started formal lessons maybe at 12. Do you want to hear about it, how I started? I used to draw, but I really had a feeling for plasticity. My mother used to light the candles Friday night, and I wasn't supposed to touch it until it burns completely down, but I just could not resist, you know, when it was just going to be almost sort of in that delicious, malleable texture or feeling, I just would have to go. And I knew it was a crime and a sin, but I just had to make something out of it. And miraculously, it wound up in my mother's vitrine, what they called. So as much as she scorned, but she still displayed it with pride. Because when it was thin and it cooled off, it looked like a fine porcelain. And also the Hungarian bread, when we always had bread on the table at meals, is kind of a glutinous texture also that you can, instead of eating it, you can manipulate it under the table and make little heads and dogs and animals out of it. So I always did something like that. And once I was ill and I was doing my thing, maybe with plasticine, and this doctor who used to come to the house said, "Did you do that? I cannot believe that she made that." And that's how it just sort of worked out that they decided that they should give me private lessons. There was no such thing as sculptor in Debrecen. However, there were two very well-known painters, and I became their student. And then I stuck with painting for many years. I actually went back to my original love of sculpture when I came to this country in stone and wood.
What was the first time that you became aware that the atmosphere was changing in Debrecen? As a child, what were the first instances that you can remember?
Drastically changing, right? When World War II was progressing and the anti-Semitic propaganda was, first of all, Hungary became an ally of Germany. And slowly, one by one, less and less people who used to greet you friendly on the street would greet you less friendly and eventually not at all. And I would hear this at home, the talk between my parents and their friends. And actually, in Hungary, all this happened much faster. Everything was very condensed in time compared to what happened in Poland and Czechoslovakia. We really didn't feel anti-Semitism until 43. And then in 44, suddenly, it just, the world fell apart, you know, we had to. Well, even before we had to wear the yellow star, suddenly there were stores having a sign out saying Magyar Üzlet, which means Hungarian store or Hungarian business, which really meant that Jews are not welcome. This is a Hungarian store. So suddenly there were Hungarians and Jews. So there we were, Hungarian Jews who lived in Hungary probably longer than most people, because Hungarians are a very mixed race. There are so many minorities, and maybe they came, the Schwabs, they came from Germany a generation or two ago, or Slovaks or Serbians or whatever. But we were there for as long as we could go back, great-grandfathers, grandfathers. So how could anybody tell us that we are not Hungarians? And suddenly they say Hungarian store, and this store might have been a toy store where we were going ever since I remember, and they greeted my mother very, very politely, and we couldn't go in, so this was just all around us.
Did you have other family in Debrecen with you that you were close with?
Yes. My mother had two cousins, girls, who were about the same age as she was, and they were also living in Debrecen, and then they also got married. So her two cousins were her best friends, and their husbands were best friends with my father. And there were also always some friends coming in from, you know, from other families, but the three girls were very close. And actually, my mother's cousin's son, who was also an only child and also about the same age as I am, was my best friend. We were brought up together. And my father had a sister, an older sister, who lived in Debrecen, who we were friendly, like family, but she was older than my mother, and not quite, it wasn't real friendship, just family.
Grandparents? Yeah.
I only had one grandmother living in Budapest because my grandfather, who I remember, I must have been maybe seven when he died. I remember him. So my grandmother lived in Budapest, and we went very often back and forth.
Your mother's mother?
My mother's mother. My father's parents died when I was maybe a year old or earlier, so I don't remember that.
Was there any point in your life that you went on vacations out of Hungary, visited other countries?
Well, my mother went fairly regularly because she had a younger brother in France, and she would go visit him, and she went once or twice. I know they went to Vienna, and then she used to go to Italy on a tour to Abbazia, it was called. Now I think it's Opatia, it's part of... whatever that is, no, it's not Yugoslavia anymore. I don't know if it's Serbia or Croatia. And the only time I went with my mother was to Italy, to this Abbazia once. And I must have been six, so I have very, very little recollection.
Was there any discussion when things started to change in Hungary of possibly moving somewhere else?
There were discussions because this was the discussion of the day among Jews altogether. And everybody came and loved to hear my father's opinion, because my father, besides that he spoke several languages and he was so handy and mechanical, he could always, even when Jews weren't allowed to have a radio, he would make something and it was inside the piano and he would listen to BBC and the Voice of America and all that. And he was an extreme optimist. It was just a pleasure to listen to him.
We're going to continue with your father's
message
to us.
I can't believe it.
Tape 2, interview with Aniko Friedberg, interviewer Tina Tito, December 14th, 1995. In the last tape, we got to the point of people coming to hear your father and discuss what was going on in the country.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So, because also, as I said before, he lived in Germany and he lived in France, he was such an optimist, and we always looked at him at home also as a person who will never let anything to happen to us, and then he will always be able to provide, and there was a Hungarian expression that he would dig the ground with his nose if he had to, but provide. You know, we really had this unconditional faith in him. And if things wouldn't have been so extremely inexplicable, I'm sure he would have, but he just it was more than a seven-headed dragon, because he could have slayed that too. And he was also a passionate man, so people would say that, well, what will happen if the Germans come in, or what will happen, even smaller things. My mother would say that we should get, I don't know how many tons of potatoes or onions or something, because maybe we won't have anything to eat. And he would say, it will never happen in this country, because Hungary is an agrarian country and there will always be food here. And it will never come in, because people wouldn't let that happen, and this is our home, and that kind of a thing. And everybody loved to hear this. You know, it was like opium, I guess, to hear this. Nevertheless, many people left. Many people left, but some people would say they are going to America. And my father would say, this is my America. This is our America, right here. Because we just had it. We had it so good. We were contented with what we had. And my mother had a younger brother in France, and my mother spoke French too, so I don't know why. I guess my father must have asked this question from himself to his dying day, and must have tortured him. But this was this wonderful thing that he was such an optimist. This was our bet. This was really, I hate to sound like I'm blaming him, but that was a big problem. And the other thing I didn't mention to you about my happy childhood, there was just one little thing, if somebody would have asked what I would like to have, what I don't have, was that I wished I had a sister or a brother. I just very much wished that. And I was told that we had had very young modern parents, and I just was told everything. Every question was answered. But after I was born, she had some kind of an operation, and she cannot have any more children. So lo and behold, in 43, I had a little brother born, Peter, and it was considered a miracle, almost like a medical miracle. And they said, well, probably from now on, if she would get pregnant again and again, it would always be a boy, because of whatever the surgery did, just affected the female side or something. So we considered this little boy as a miracle. And my father used to say that this is going to be our peace baby. This baby will bring peace to the world. And of course, he loved me, and there were no buts. But still, this was a little boy, and it was that I was 15, and I had this baby boy who I really thought he was mine. I mean, my parents thought it was theirs, but I knew it was mine, and I really cared for him and walked him all the time. And when I would walk with him, I remember, to a park nearby, I would sit down and turn my little ring, which had a stone in it, around and held the carriage so people should think that I am the mother. And I was very tall. I was as tall as I am now, so I always look much older than I am, except now, I hope. And so this is very important to say, because there was this added joy in our lives for such a short time, and this was another reason that my mother had to go, that I will tell you when we got there, because of the baby, that she had to go to the other side.
Let's continue now. So we're beginning, your father's creating, did they take away radios from you?
He was able to fabricate things. My father could do anything. I mean, he was a mechanical engineer, but if you would give him a musical instrument he has never seen before, he could take it apart and put it together.
When you say you weren't allowed to have a radio, did you have to bring your radio somewhere? Was this required from the government?
It was definitely. It was part of the, there was always so-called Jido Terveyn, you know, Jew law. You know, there were always new restrictions. And I don't really know the details, why, but I know you weren't supposed to have one and you weren't allowed to listen to it.
In 1943, when this was beginning, where did your father work at this time?
Well, he always had his own business besides having his main interest being invention, but he also had other businesses related to mechanical. He was a representative of Fiat automobiles in Hungary from, you know, with this once in a while, this man from Torino once every 2 years came to the house. I remember a big festive lunch for him and things like that.
Was he able to keep his job during this time?
He was able to keep it until, again, I don't know why. I could have been old enough to know these things, but I don't know exactly the date when he was recruited into to the Hungarian army, just like any other Hungarian. And he was an officer, and he was wearing a uniform, and he was proud of it, just proud of his uniform. And I was very proud of him because he looked so handsome and with the decoration and everything. And then I don't know how much later, of course, the uniform was taken away from him and he became part of the labor camp. I guess it was called the labor camp. And he had to wear, on top of his civilian clothes, a large yellow band. And we didn't see him. I don't even know where he was, even though he did come home on a furlough, I guess. Maybe twice for a short time. So
your mother now had you, your little
brother? My mother had me and my little brother. And the German nanny I had to go back years before to Austria. She was from Vienna because of after the Anschluss there, every Austrian citizen had to go back to Hungary. And she was a wonderful woman, by the way. I loved her, and she loved our whole family. She was never married. She always said that she wanted to leave everything to me one day. And even though we never imagined anything like this to happen, but there was this impending insecurity of some kind of a tragedy in the air, because my mother told me to remember Amal, that was her name, her address in Vienna, because just in case, you never know where we'll be thrown away from each other, maybe, that we can always meet there. And I still remember her address there.
What was her full name?
Amalia Begus, and it was 26 Schleifmüllergasse in Wien, Vienna. So I never went back there, and I never even considered it.
What went on from this point? What happened? Your mother had enough money to support you in the same manner?
We stayed in the same apartment, I guess, yes. See, one thing about the way we lived, I think about that sometimes, because it is also so different from the way things are in America, that I never heard this word money around me. You know, it was just, you never asked anybody how much money you make or how do you make a living or where it comes from. It just, I had everything I needed, but I never had more than I needed. It just wasn't something that you would ever want. It wasn't a nice thing to think that way.
What was the first time that you felt threatened in your apartment?
Well, we were alone in the apartment, and my grandmother, who lived in Budapest, came down to stay with us because she was afraid of the bombardment in Budapest. Well, we had already some bombardments in Debrecen, but not such massive than in Budapest, and I guess the fear was larger in the capital city would be bombed more. By the way, I just have to regress that, because sometimes people think that, well, you suffered during the war, how about us? Everybody suffered during the war. All Hungarians suffered during the war. It was a terrible thing to have the bombs fall and run down to the middle of the night to the air raid shelters and have your loved ones and the men and the brothers and sons to go to the front someplace and not know where they were. But we also had that. You know, whenever, I remember this was even before when my father was still at home, in the middle of the night they would wake me up because I didn't hear the sirens in those days, that quickly, and I was still going to school, and it must have been after February 1943 because I had my little brother already, and he had a little basket that they called the Moses basket, and they would put him quickly into the basket, and we would run down in the middle of the night in the three stories down and then further down to this designated air raid shelter very many times in the middle of the night and spend the whole night there and hear bombs coming here and there. So anyway, my grandmother was living with us.
What was her full name, your grandmother?
Well, she was Mrs. Benedek, and her first name was Charlotte. In Hungarian, it was Charlotte, and they called her Shari.
How old was she at this time?
It's incredible. She was so young. She was in her middle 50s. She wasn't one of these very old-looking ladies. She had dark hair and a lovely face. I remember her hair very well because she allowed me to comb her and play with her hair. My mother called it torture her. I would never dare to do it to my mother, but my grandma, you know how grandmothers are. I'm a grandmother now, so I could play hairdresser with my grandmother.
Right.
All the time.
Let's move on from that point. What happened to your family?
So we were, when the Germans came in 1944, mid-March, it was a Sunday. Every Sunday I went to this painter's house to paint with him. He had a model there, and I just loved, could hardly wait for Sunday, and I spent a couple of hours there, and I was going on the home, and it was still light in the afternoon, and I hear all these noises above, and I look up, and I see all these planes, lots of planes coming above. It was kind of exciting, you know, I never saw so many planes, and I went home, and then they were telling me that evening that the Germans occupied Hungary that day. I remember coming with the paintings under my arm and very, very clear image, all those planes above.
But you were still going out. Your parents didn't force you to stay in the apartment.
No, I was still going to school.
Still going to
the convent school.
How about rationing? How about food? Was it rationed at that point?
Well, it wasn't. There was no rationing that I recall. It was just a different diet. You know, the Hungarians are not big meat eaters anyway. You know, we would have meat a couple of times a week, and the rest of the week would be other vegetables and like pasta kind of dishes. So they just made do. They substituted. I wasn't into cooking in those days, you know, but we were never hungry, and there was always something nice. Hungarian cooking is not an expensive cooking, partly by necessity and partly it's even taste. You know, it was always a nice soup. Every meal started with a big soup, and the meat portions were always small, reasonably small, and whatever. And I'm so glad that you are there to ask me questions, because I just get sidetracked the time.
The Germans are now in. It's March. It's winter.
So it's the spring. March 15 is one of the largest Hungarian national holidays, by the way. It's from the 1848 freedom fight war. It's a symbol for Hungarian freedom. And I remember a week later there were graffiti for the first time ever on the walls in Debrecen saying that our father Kossuth would have fought last Sunday. You know, Kossuth was one of the leaders, K-O-S-S-U-T-H, who have, was one of the symbols, the leaders of the freedom fight. So even though there was no resistance to speak of in Hungary, also, in all fairness, you have to know Hungary is a very, very small country, and it's geographically placed in the middle of all this east and west and north and south. And so every time a war started in Europe, Hungary being really an agrarian country, a wheat-producing country, and they had rich soil and all that, they would run it over right away to feed their armies. So it wasn't an industrial country. It was almost like a feudal society before then. So there wasn't much room for resistance. So this happened in mid-March, and then things happened in very, very fast succession. I was still going to school, but the Jews had to wear a yellow star on everything, all the garments.
On the arm?
No, on your chest, on the coat. On, if you went on the street, it had to be visible. When you had wore a coat, it had to be on the coat. I remember going to this convent school, because I walked to school and back and forth. I had to walk the length of the main street and turn in. And I remember the thoughts that here is the big yellow star, people come across. Now, what is better if I put my lapel over it, or maybe I should button it up so it should show? So, you know, these things were in the forefront of my mind. And then I went to school and I took my coat off and hung it, and then I was like all the other girls for a while. Was no talk about what's happening. But the school ended earlier than we had also air raids in school, so the school ended much earlier than a regular school year would have anyway. I don't even remember if it ended at all. I don't remember if there were any exams that year. And we had a nice large apartment in this building, so when the Germans came in, our apartment was recruited right away. But they let us stay there. We had two rooms, and this SS officer lived in the biggest room, in the living room. I remember his name also, Uri Schmidtke from Leipzig. And after a while, he kind of befriended us. He was an SS officer, and he loved my little brother. I remember there was a photograph next to his bed, because our we still had a maid. That was interesting. It, through all this, we had a living maid. And the maid cleaned his room, and so we knew what's happening in his room, that there was a picture of a young woman and a baby next to his bed. And then every once in a while, he would smell potatoes roasting, and he would say, you know, like a French fries, I remember, kind of French fries, Rochebel. And then he said, I love that. And then my mother said, would you like to have a plate? And then he had it, and he was very grateful for it. And once my aunt came to visit my father's sister, who was much more, they were observant, and she also was more outspoken. My mother was shy, and they were talking to this German soldier officer, and I remember she asked him, but what would you do if Hitler would say that you have to kill us? And he said, that wouldn't happen, but I would have to obey orders. I remember that. Soon after that, we were taken out of our home, and I just remember we were taken to a designated ghetto area, not what used to be the ghetto, but just sort of out of the main street area. They took a large house, and they put all the Jewish families in those few houses.
Where was it located? What was the street?
It was called Hatvan Street, H-A-T-V-A-N, Hatvani. I'm not sure anymore, Hatvan, it's been such a long time. And one evening, a jar of some kind of a condensed milk with sugar and everything flew over where we lived. I don't know how my mother knew that this was this officer who threw it over for the baby, because it was like, you know, milk and with sugar or something like that. So he did, probably he risked his life even to do something like that, but then we never heard from him anymore. And we stayed in this ghetto area. We had a very small room over, I don't know, that used to be the caretaker's room or something like that, where we lived. And from there, we were taken, I really don't know how long we stayed there, weeks, month. We were taken to an area outside of Debrecen called the Brick Factory. The Brick Factory.
Could you spell that?
Brick Factory?
Yes, and you said the name.
Oh, it's the Hungarian word for Brick Factory, Téglagyár. The Brick Factory was not a factory where they were making bricks, just I guess they were storing bricks there. It had a roof and no sides. What would you call that structure
carport,
like that?
Like
a carport, long like a carport. And so, you know, exposed to the elements, no bed or nothing, that's where we were again for I don't know how long, a week, two, I have no idea, three. I remember there also we heard the bombarding of Debrecen. And we were lying on our stomach there on the grass while this happened, and we saw the planes and bombs up in the distance, but not where we were.
So we were talking about late spring?
Yes.
May?
Late, probably.
Because it wasn't too cold for you?
I remember having coats on then. Yeah, but it was not too cold to, nevertheless, I don't remember suffering from cold or anything, so it must have been very late spring. And from there we were guarded by the gendarme. And
Hungarian?
Hungarian gendarme. And they were bad. They were bad.
They were bad. Explain how they were bad.
These were boys brought up from the villages who probably volunteered for this. They were just the lords over all these people for life and death. And also, once they called my mother in. They used to call women in once in a while to the office, and they would torture them to tell where they have money hidden, where in what they left. And I was shielded. From me, my mother shielded these things, but I know when she came back that she couldn't wear her shoes, and then somebody said that they beat her, the sole of her feet, with something. It was swollen. And there was nothing hidden. But by then we had to, everything was for a long time taken. I remember when we had, all the Jews had to give every gold, you know, every jewelry. I mean, I had a little neck chain with a little medal, you know, a teeny little earring. Everything had to be, we really had nothing. We had nothing except what we had done. So from there, one day they put us in the cattle cars, because maybe this was the logistics of this being in this brick factory area that was next to the tracks, some kind of a railroad tracks for shipping us. And I've heard, I talked to other survivors before, and it's interesting how similar our stories are and how different our stories are. Even the cattle cars are not for human transportation as is, but it's a big difference if you're 40 or 80 or 120. We were 120 in a cattle car. Maybe because it was just so it was like a last minute thing. Like, actually, I have to retract, but I have to tell you that By New Year's Eve of 1943 to 1944, my father was home and my parents had a small New Year's party. You know, nothing raucous, just a few friends together. And it was a warmish Christmas, New Year's night, and they opened the window at midnight and they sang the Marseillaise. And they said it was just as a symbol of feeling that victory is at hand. You know, we won the war, because this was after the Stalingrad battle, and every day my father heard on the radio that the Americans are planning to the landing, and they will be here any minute. They'll be here any minute. So we figured, you know, there was no question about the Germans having lost the war already, but they're just. Still, they can't stop. So that was the background. And so everything happened so fast that the Hungarian Jews had to be liquidated at the speediest way. So we went into the cattle cars, and we got a little lucky because my mother had the baby. The cattle car has just one little narrow opening on one side. And they let us sit under that opening. It turned out that this nice present from this German who threw this condensed food did the baby more harm than good, because that's the only food we had somehow with us, and we kept giving it to him, and he had a terrible diarrhea, dysentery in the cattle car. And my mother at one point hung his little clothes on that window to dry, and somebody pulled it out from outside, so he didn't even have that. So that I remember was a terrible thing. And we were in the cattle car extremely long. I just cannot tell you how long, like 2 weeks. And we didn't know where we were going, and it was dark, and of course there is no water and no hygiene and no nothing. And actually, that's where I learned that my young and beautiful little mother is what a strong person she is. Because she really kept my spirit up. She never complained and said, "Don't worry, the war is almost over, and these people, these are just not good people, and they are ignorant people, but wherever we'll go, Germans are still civilized people. They are in a war. They're doing what they have to. But you'll see, we'll get there. We'll probably have to work, and we are strong and young, and we'll work. And soon enough, it will be over, and Daddy will be at the gates waiting for us." So you know, that's how it was. And the reason it took such a long time to go to, we didn't know our destination, which through Czechoslovakia to go to Auschwitz, Poland, shouldn't have taken that long time, was that very many times they just pushed us off to another track, and the cars, just the railroad, just sat there on the tracks for overnight or a day or two, and we had no idea what's going on.
Let's stop the tape. We'll continue.
Okay.
Tape 3, interview with Aniko Friedberg, Interviewer Tina Tito, December 14th, 1995. We're going on the tracks. You're headed for a destination. Continue, please.
Yeah, so finally we arrive.
Day or night?
Day. Daytime. No idea what time of the day, what day, or even what month at this point. And they opened the doors. And by then there were a couple of many older people or sickly people who were by the door. I remember them falling out. Some didn't survive the trip. And we are getting off, and I am holding the baby. Like usually, I wanted to hold the baby. And there is this, we're still standing in the doorway, and there is this handsome, tall German officer standing there. And my mother says to me that, you see what a nice man, and you sort of with a polite expression or something that she immediately thought, see what a nice man. And I'm holding the baby and I get off, and he was by then saying to some people that you go this way and you go that way. And it's my turn, and he says, give the baby to an older person. And you know, I didn't want to first, but my mother said, well, that's my baby. He said, good, then give it to her. So my mother took the baby, and he says, well, then you go that way and you go that way. I remember they went right and I went left. And my mother said, but she's also my baby. Please let her come with me also. And the man, who turned out to be Mengele, said that, but she's young and she can walk and you're going to buy bus. And then my mother smiled and she looked at me like, you see, I told you so, kind of a smile, that everything will be fine. So, and she left with the baby and my grandmother and my aunt. And my little six-year-old cousin, my aunt had a six-year-old child. And I've never seen them again. And, you know, then we marched quite a while. I remember going through this gate, which says Arbeit macht frei. Well, I still thought we're going to a labor camp. And then we were going to go through a long line where they shaved us. We went into a large hall where we were waiting, and then they said, "Take off everything." And I had a coat on that was a brand new coat. I got that coat a couple of months prior to that. My mother had it made for me because that was supposed to be more like a big girlish coat. And so we were supposed to not wear it until the fall. And when we left, my mother said, put that on and your best shoe and everything. And I said, how come? When we left our apartment, I'm going back then a little bit. And she said, well, it's because you never know what you will have left with, and I want the best, you wear the best. So I had this coat that I was so proud of because it had a line that little girls didn't wear. And so they said, put everything on the floor. So I took off this coat and I was looking where I can hang it. And I saw some kind of a knobs, kind of a thing in the wall, and I was going there to hang my coat. And the next thing I know that this big woman, I don't know if she was German. I don't think she was German. She spoke German, but I think she had some kind of an accent. She came over and she said, what do you think you're arrived to a vacation? And she gave me a tremendous, tremendous blow to my head, and that I really blanked out for a minute. And so then I had to take everything off, and I didn't understand what everything meant until I understood what everything means. And then we were lined up where they were shaving our head and completely. And then when we were coming out through the other door, we were still young girls, you know, when we looked at each other. There were a few girls with me who I knew from Debrecen. Some of them went to the same school or even the same class. And we looked at each other and we started to giggle, kind, because we didn't recognize each other. We did not recognize each other. You know, it's just standing there completely naked with bald head. It just changed your whole face. I remember that. But what I was always thinking of, that I'm glad that my mother and the others went to a better place, that they went by bus and they don't know this. What will they think when they'll see us again? But I'm glad that they are not here. And then came a terrible couple of months in Auschwitz. Again, I was at the worst place in Auschwitz. Now, you think Auschwitz is Auschwitz, and I used to think so too, until I started to talk to several other Auschwitz survivors about this, which really didn't happen until a few years ago. And I realized that where we stayed, this barrack was the worst of them all, because we were just put into this barrack, very, very many of us. And there was nothing there. We just, at night, whenever we fell asleep, we just fell on top of each other. You know, there was no room to straighten a leg or anything. That's how we lived. And very many got sick and died. And I had a terrible illness too. It was one of the illnesses that was many had. I started to get this. My lips broke out.
Sores,
and then it went inside. I was on my palate and down my throat.
Ulcers.
Something, and I couldn't swallow. And I remember I was just my saliva was running, and we had to. I was together with this couple of girls who, as I said, I remembered them from Debrecen, and they were in the same school with me, and then also this sisters, Viola and Anitza Kish, who I remembered from Debrecen, who I was friendly with, especially the one that was my age and her older sister. And we really supported each other, because I mean, I was so ill. You know what a tse lapel is? A tse lapel? There was a tse lapel very often. When they blew the whistle, in no time we had to be out, day or night, whatever the weather was, and stand in rows of five like this. And this SS woman, the dog would come and count us. And we would stand there sometimes for hours. They were counting us over and over again. And if you couldn't stand up, then every day I think the truck came, to which they threw on the truck the bodies, whether you were dead or very ill. So at one point I couldn't stand up, and I said, I don't care. I really never cared. No, none of us cared at that point. There was no such thing as fear or anything. And they held me up, and we did those things for each other. You know, it's just amazing what very young people can do and face and live up to.
I'm sorry. Were you all Hungarians in this barrack?
All Hungarians.
Do you know the name of the barrack? Did it have a name, the barrack?
It had a name. I think it was called B. Now, I didn't know that. I forgot that also. But a couple of years ago, when I was talking to others, and they said, which barracks were you in A or B? And I said, I don't remember. And then it turned out, oh, you were in that one, because I remember the name of my Lager Älteste, Shoshana. She was Czech or Slovak Jewish girl. Yes, she was still, must have been 19, but she looked to me like a much older and a beauty, because she was there for many years, and she somehow survived all those horrors, who knows how and why, and they made her a Lager Älteste.
Did you, after Appel, did you do anything?
No, we did nothing. And I didn't even know. We didn't know there were people working in Auschwitz or there was anybody living in any other way. We were just piled up. I just remember once we were going to the latrine or something, and we see all this group of strange people. They had their clothes, funny clothes. I said, who are they? And they were together. They were like families together, like children also. And they said, those are gypsies. Gypsies? You know, I mean, I never saw a gypsy from really close, and I didn't know that gypsies were also had the same fate planned for as we were. And I remember the night they took the gypsies away, because we heard all the screaming when they just suddenly took the gypsies. The gypsies, it's that some kind of a national or racial characteristics or their culture, they are much more demonstrative and they scream, you know. The Jews were, I don't know if it's discipline or what it is, but they just were quiet. But they really screamed terribly, I remember that. So anyway, this was Auschwitz. And I remember once weird things. Once we got some kind of a postcard, and they said, address it and write something. Everybody got a postcard and a pencil. Of course, we knew already that we were in hell and worse. And we all wrote probably the same thing. I addressed it to my mother. But we said, but there is no one to write it to. Doesn't matter. Write it as if they were still there. I don't know what purpose that served. And I think I addressed it to our old address. And I said, dear mom and dad, I'm here and I'm fine and don't worry about me, or something like that. And I remember also once I went over, which I wasn't supposed to, but I went over to this barbed wire where a soldier was standing on the other side with the gun, a Wehrmacht soldier. You know, they weren't as bad as the supposedly as the SS, even though I didn't know the difference then. And I went over and I said, may I ask you something in German? And he said, well, what? I said, well, do you know where the mothers and the children are? And he said, why? And so I said, because I would like you to, if you know, I would like you to give a message to my mother. And I remember I said to him that, you know, she's very beautiful and my baby and this and that. I gave a little description. And then I'm sure she's very worried about me. And could you please go over, find her and say that I'm fine. So anyway, a couple of days later, whenever I saw this soldier again, I said, did you? And he said, I did. I remember that.
Any other memories from
Auschwitz?
Auschwitz. Food. Food? How did they feed you?
We had to stand on this zelapel once a day, and they brought some kind of a, you know, one. The first person got some in a bowl, some kind of a liquid, inedible liquid, and it would take a few sips and give it to the first person behind and behind and behind. This is one very good way to spread all this infectious, the typhoid and all this infectious things anyway. And the drink was inedible. And I decided all the time that whatever they give me, I will drink it and eat it, because that's what I would have to do for my mother. And I remember the sisters who I mentioned, that's why I mentioned them, because they couldn't take it. They couldn't take a sip of this. It's so bad they couldn't. And they both died right there. They were before they weren't put in a crematorium or anything, but they died like so many others because of weakness and starvation. So I ate everything. I didn't care what it was. I just everything I ate. And one very surreal thing I remember that was even in Auschwitz, it was surreal. One day they marched us out and we had to sit on this side of the road in like a yoga position. And I don't remember if we got for that day some kind of a clothes, different clothes. Well, we would always get something different to wear. We had to go frequently. We went to the bath, you know, which was a disinfectant in this big room where there were holes in the ceiling. And then we were told that, we always had water coming out of there, but that was the same where the cyclone gas came from. And when we were finished, then they would throw us some kind of a clothes, you know, from whoever, whatever they had.
You all looked the same or different?
Disinfected clothes. No, what they took off, I guess, from the bodies. They disinfected everything. Clean it was. Everything was clean. And It was just one of the odd things that me and this top, a girl who was as tall as I was, we always got the shortest little, some kind of a little skirt. You know, some short girls got long skirts or whatever. That's how it worked out. So once they took us to the side of the road, and we were supposed to wait for something. And then they brought some band from someplace. I don't know if it was also an inmates band. But it wasn't from that part of Auschwitz where we were, because we didn't know this before God already, there is such a thing as music. And I remember just we were sitting there, it seemed like all day, and we were so weak, you know, we just can't sit up straight. And then suddenly a delegation comes, and it's like with Swiss Red Cross or something. I just knew this is Swiss Red Cross, and they just march fast through in the middle of the road. And I figured they will have to talk to us. They will have to ask something. They will have to look. But nobody did. This was just, when I look back, then I had the sense that this was something very strange, but it was like, you know, Fellini-esque scene. They just marched through the Red Cross and the delegation, and that's it. And then we went back to the same.
How long were you in Auschwitz?
Toward the fall, one day, Mengele, who used to come many times just to look over us and to, you know, to select, find, try to find twins, so always checking the craniums, came over and selected a few, you, and they took us. So we went. We didn't know where we were going, and we went to another part of Auschwitz. And they gave us some kind of a uniform, a gray dress, and there was a number on it. So we knew it's something just good can happen, because we didn't have a number in Auschwitz. We weren't even in anybody's bookkeeping.
We weren't even processed.
We were just meat fodder to go from one place into the gas chambers. So we got this dress with a number, and then we were put in cattle cars again. And it wasn't such a long ride, and it wasn't such a bad ride. As a matter of fact, everything a little better seemed like wonderful at that point. And they took us from Auschwitz, Poland, toward the western part of Germany. And we went into this, what's called Lager Allendorf. No, Lager Münchmühle, I'm sorry, Fabrik Allendorf, when I worked, Münchmühle, Munchmühle, two dots under U. And these ordinary barracks, they had bunk beds in it. I mean, we really thought we arrived in heaven, paradise. And we got some meal, and for about 2 or 3 weeks, because we were able to walk, but we were still too weak to do anything. So for about 2 or 3 weeks, we would get some kind of a meal, maybe twice a day or even 3 times a day, some breakfast, something. We just couldn't believe what are they doing to us. We didn't have to work or anything. So at the end of this period, whatever it was, they took us over to Fabrik Allendorf, which was about, I don't know, maybe an hour walk through this pine forest, to a very, very large underground factory complex, which I know now was owned by Dynamit Noble, who was one of the largest ammunition factories of Nazi Germany, grenade and bomb factories. And we did the whole thing from A to Z, filling with this poisonous, if we called it the grenades. And I did work for a short time at the filling station, and then soon after that they put me at the very end of the mass production, when the things just come rolling down, where my job was because I think I was probably the tallest there, and you know, I had broad shoulders and round face, something. They thought I was just strong, and I had to pick these grenades the way they rolled up and flip it, put it over into a little trolley kind of thing that had grates, and probably 16 would go into one of these things, and that rolled right out of the building, and where on the other side were the Russian prisoners of war who would put it in trains.
How long did you work there?
And I worked there until April 45, till April 6th, something like that, 45. So, I don't know, 9 months, whatever it was.
Better conditions for you?
It was better conditions, definitely, and in the beginning we especially appreciated the better conditions. Then, of course, it got, it got very difficult because we had to, these grenades I had to carry weighed almost as much as I did, and it was very hard for me to pick up even one. I remember the first few days when we went back, these were all-night shifts. After went back after 12 hours, and we were given the dinner, and with the spoon, I couldn't hold the spoon. My hands were I just couldn't hold it. My fingers were swollen. And I complained, oh, it's so heavy, I can't. I said, you better do it, because next week you have to do 36, and the week after that, I don't know, 50, and you have to do up to, 120 a night. So it just sounded like it's an impossibility. Well, it wasn't impossible. I learned to do it, and I must say I did it even with ease. It's somehow in the first time in my life I realized that how with smarts, you know, you can figure out how to do things. And you know, I flipped it this way and I flipped it that way, and I just got it in there, and I almost liked it. It was I felt like I was doing something. I was proud of myself.
Were you basically Hungarians in this group?
All Hungarians. So they picked, at that time, 1,000 young Hungarian women.
What happened after this place? What happened to you?
So when we were there, toward the end, was almost there was no more raids, even, because the American planes were constantly overhead, and sometimes they would come down so low that we could see the pilot. And we always had this unshakable faith that they know who we are. And we were happy when we saw the bombs falling next to us anywhere, because they knew that they know who we are and they're not going to drop anything on us. The Germans were running right and left, and we were just saying, good, good, you know. And so one day they just evacuated the camp, and we started this march toward the center of Germany. We were mostly marching in the dark at night, and in the daytime we were in school buildings or something. We also marched in daytime because I remember seeing so many German families on the road running in the other direction, and we were just stepping on the highway. We were just stepping over all kinds of possessions that people dropped or whatever.
What kind of shoes did you have for this morning?
We were all the time, we had no shoes while we were in this factory. I'm glad you asked. We had so-called klumpe. It was like the Dutch girls wear, wooden clogs. Wooden clogs, that's what we had, wooden clogs. And so it was very hard. Everybody's toes were frozen, and it was very, very difficult.
How long did you march?
What happened was that we were marching already 4 or 5 days, and many of us, and my girlfriend I had, said that I don't care what they do to me. I'm not more good. I care. My feet are hurt and it's bleeding, and I cannot take another step, and I'm sitting down. And of course, they would holler that whoever sits down or slows down will shoot, and you know, all these things. And then suddenly we realized that they start tearing their insignia off. once we notice that somebody's changing into a civilian clothes, an SS woman. And then the next thing I hear that somebody, there were many times forest that we were on the roadside, that somebody ran into the forest. So I said, really? You know. So then we decided that next time we see a forest, we'll run into. But I wasn't the first one, maybe not even the second one. It didn't occur to me that, you know, you can do that, but when somebody did it. So a few days after, we decided next time there is a forest, we'll run in, and that's what we did. And in this forest, we ran inside, but by then we heard constantly the front behind us. We heard the cannons, you know, we heard the war coming right in our tracks practically. And we knew those are the Americans. And so we ran into the forest, and we still heard these noises, and the day was coming to an end, and we were behind we picked a large tree, and we were there, three or four of us. And suddenly everything went quiet, and we didn't hear the cannons or anything anymore, and we were very scared. The night came, and there was no noise and nothing. And we were wondering what could have happened. And we spent another day there, and we were taking turns. Now one person would always be the lookout, and the other slept. And I think maybe the second night, I was sleeping, and this other girl was the lookout, and she said, oh, wake up, they discovered us, which off we are finished. I said, really? Where? She said, I've seen somebody's coming, a couple of men are coming, and they're having a gun in their hand, and they're coming, and they have, you think they saw us? Yes, I think they saw us, and they're coming toward us. So I figured that's it. So the men came toward us, and they were in civilian clothes, and they turned out to be French prisoners of war who were working for a farmer nearby. And we were able to communicate in German with them, but I also spoke, and another girl, a little French, not very good at both, but, and they said who they were, and they said what happened was that there is an airport nearby, and where there was a little fighting, so the Americans were held up, but don't worry, it's not going to last long, they're just going to be here, it's a question of maybe a day or two. And that we should stay there in the forest, and after midnight they will come back and they will bring us some food, and then they will lead us to this farmer's house, and they will hide us above the stable in the straw. And that's exactly what happened. They took us there, and then we stayed there a couple of days in the straw, and always they came in the middle of the night and they brought us the first bread and potato or something fantastic like that.
And then what happened? You left the farm?
And then one day, there was a little round hole from which we could see the street and the little house across the street. And again, one girl looks out and she says, again, that they discovered us because, said, well, how could they? Said, well, from the house across the street, they are pushing out a gun toward us. Where? How? She says, right from the top of the house, a similar round hole, she saw they're pushing out a gun. So I remember I creeped up, kind of look out through this hole, and they're really pushing something, and it comes out, and it's a white flag. Yeah, it was just incredible. And then right after that, we saw the Americans in the jeeps coming in and standing up, and they were throwing the rations, what we didn't know what it was, but chocolate bars and cheese and everything right and left to the Germans, which a little bit bothered us. You know, there we are still starving, and to these Germans, who we were hoping they were just, I don't know, to just annihilate everything. They were throwing all the food right and left.
We're going to stop the tape. Thank you.
Tape 4, Interview with Aniko Friedberg, Interviewer Tina Tito, December 14, 1995. We're at your liberation. You see the Americans around you.
Yes.
How did you feel? What was going on in your head?
We were so desensitized. I guess had to be some kind of an elation, but not what you expect. We were just sort of drifting from one state into the other. And actually, it was never a real surprise because, and I compared notes with some of my friends since then, this last 4 years. You know, we all felt the same way, that we had such an unshakable faith in that the good will win and the bad will be punished and that this can only end this way. It's like almost like the end of this terrible fairy tale that, and then suddenly all is well. Because we never really suffered psychologically because we really never believed what was happening, even though the Germans so many times would say things that you see that black smoke there, that's your family or that's who they are, and we would smell it, and we had no reason to doubt it, but we just never believed it for a moment because there was something called the Latrina news. For somehow everybody went there because there was always someone who heard, said, you know what I heard. And that's where we got our news information. And then they would say, I heard that the mothers and the children and the older people, the little kid children, were taken to Switzerland and they are in a sanatorium. And then the word would spread very fast and they would say, oh, wonderful, as long as they just don't see what we are going through. Also, through this whole thing, I was keeping a very, very thorough list in my mind of everybody and everybody's name and face who was nice. So when I go back home, I'm going to tell my father and they're going to give them something. And also people who were very bad, so they will be punished. You know, like the good will be punished and the good will be rewarded and the bad will be punished. When all this is true. So the liberation was just part of this whole thing.
Where did they liberate you? Where did you find yourself at that point?
Well, it was about 6 days or a week away west of the factory, and I didn't know until about 4 years ago, it will be 5 years, the details. And about 6 or 7 years ago, I got a letter from the mayor of Stadt Allendorf, which we didn't know then that there was a town nearby. We'd never saw a human being or saw a building other than the factory where we worked. And they tracked me as well as other survivors down through the Swiss Red Cross. I guess when we were liberated, they took our fingerprints and some data, and they were able to track us down. Not everybody, but most people, they were able to track us down. And they contacted us, and the letter said, it was a very, very moving letter, that the school children in the area started a research project. They want to know what happened in the outskirts of their native town, which was actually a village when we were there. Since then, it became a town. It grew like the rest of the Germany. And a history professor at the college was leading these studies. And they were trying to find out from their parents and grandparents, but nobody would answer them. And this professor, Harald Horn, was leading the research, and there was no question in their mind that there was something, because this whole large area where the factories were, you could still, when you went close by, you could still smell this toxic gas in the air. And they still, after so many years, it was 44 years later, they still couldn't grow things there, and they couldn't have cattle underground. And they really, you know, really wanted to know. And they were wondering if we could give any information, if we have any memorabilia or how we felt or whatever we could, if they know how hard it is for us and that maybe it's impossible for many of us, but how they would appreciate it. The goal is that we want to educate our children and people that this should never happen again. So I was completely broken up because for all these 45 years, I just had to live with having this completely suppressed. Why? I guess because I wanted to lead a quote-unquote normal life. So in order to live on and, you know, work and get married and have children and bring them up, and you just had to block this out. And I didn't find myself capable of doing this. On the other hand, I just had this feeling that I have to do this. So I was going back and forth, torturing myself between these two extremes. And then I decided for the first time, I sought out a psychologist. And I went to her. By the way, she was a Christian woman who was extremely helpful. And she said, tell me, and I will write it for you. And I was going there maybe 6-8 months before we gave birth to an answer. And then finally, they had them, and that they also, this letter asked them, would you be willing eventually to come to a reunion, which we are planning in a year or a year and a half or something, in this site? I mean, in my mind, this site really didn't exist on this world, in this world, you know, so then to take a trip there. So anyway, I went. You were allowed to bring someone with you. They were paying your full fare and they for a week and half of your companions. I took my daughter. And I must say I had these paranoid thoughts to myself on the plane that probably they hijacked the plane and they put us right back underground and nobody will ever know what happened to us and, you know. And so I arrived, and the whole town was getting ready for this for a long time. And they had, with the German precision and planning, you know, the whole week, the festivities were planned, and they were, everything was kosher, by the way, and there was huge buffets, and the local women were all baking and cooking and serving us and taking our coat and taking back. So it really was kind of surreal. And they had lectures, and they had dignitaries, and they had German television and radio. The main thing, of course, was to see each other for the first time. Nobody, of course, nobody recognized anybody after 45 years. It's a difference between being 15 or 60. And but the most interesting and the greatest thing for me and for everybody else was that all this paranoia that we thought we were living with, that only I thought these things on the plane, it turned out everybody thought that on the plane. Only I had these feelings for 45 years that should I say it or shouldn't I say it? Or why is it that I go down to this German deli which has been there forever and I ask for, I don't know, cream cheese and I look at this guy behind the counter and I suddenly see him in a Nazi uniform in my mind. So it turned out everybody went through this. So that was very cathartic right away, that not crazy.
So let's go back now that you've been back again in this life.
Yes.
And go back to 1945 when you were liberated. Where did you go? Did you go to the American camp?
So for a while we were in some kind of a school building where we had one woman who was one of us, an older woman. She must have been at least 30, you know, was like a mother figure. And We didn't like it there, me and my girlfriends, because it was like American soldiers came and went, and some girls went with them, and we were kind of scared and didn't like this whole thing. And then one day, this woman who took care of us said that there are a few American Red Cross ladies who came and wanted to know, are there any girls who speak German and English? And she said, yes, as a matter of fact, there are a few who were, you know, nice girls. And she asked why, and she said, well, because we are in this in at this nearby large airport base, and we would need somebody, a few people who could translate or interpret for us. So she asked us, would you like to go? And said, oh, yes, we would like to go. So 1, 2, 3, we got in the car with them, and we went over to, it was called Fritzlar, this airport where we went.
Fritzlar,
F-R-I-T-Z-L-A-R. And after that, we moved with the whole base to another airport base nearby, but I don't remember the name of that. And so these women were very, very nice to us, the Red Cross ladies, and her name was Betty Cushing, I remember. And the story was that we had a little room, like a little maid's room, but with two of us, but it was very nice, a two-way room, and that in the Red Cross building with the Red Cross cafeteria, that we never, ever had to interpret anything. Well, we were baking donuts for the rest of our stay. So they gave us a donut mix, and they said, this is the hot oil, and there was this wire basket with the grids, and, you know, you roll it out, and you make the donut shapes and put it in the wire basket and drop it in the burning oil and take it out. Well, needless to say that for about a month, I had all kinds of grid shapes on my arm because I was never in a kitchen before with hot. Before that, if there was hot oil in the kitchen, they would have probably told me stay out. But I learned how to make donuts real fast. As a matter of fact, I put on a lot of weight real fast from the skeletal condition that I was in. I was feeling out because we also had the keys to the basement where the food was, where they had the cocoa mixture and egg powder mixture and peanut butter mixture. None of these things that exist in Hungary ever. And so we used to take this in a big cup and kind of mix it together with instant milk and eat it by the spoonful. So this was the diet. But so this is how the whole summer went by. And then the fall, I don't want to get into the details how, but there was this girl who went back to Hungary. Not one of us, but went through there and said she's going back to Hungary because she has a boyfriend there. She wants to find him and come back and bring him out also, and they'll go to America. And she wanted to know, would we want to tell her where our family lived and their names, because maybe she would try to find out if they are there. So we gave it to her. And then we haven't heard from her for a couple of months, and we didn't believe in this whole thing anyway. Lo and behold, she came back. She found her boyfriend. She brought her back, and she came to the base just to tell us that I looked for your families, and you, Eva, you have nobody left, and you, Aniko, have nobody left, and you, Agi, have nobody left. And you, Aniko, you know, you have your father is there. I was the only person, you know, your father is there. So from that moment on, that nobody could keep me there. And they really tried, very nice. They wanted to bring me to America, and they'll adopt me, and they'll put me to art, through art school and all kinds of things, and begged me not to go back to Hungary because it's big disarray and mess, and the roads are in bad condition, and there's still no mass transportation, the trains are not running, and the Russians are doing terrible things there. But all this went one ear in, the other out, and I left. They have given me all kinds of things to take with me, you know, like chocolate and cigarettes and cheese and things like that in a bag. And it took me a couple of weeks, and I went back to Budapest. And
in the summer of 45?
Just like the fall of 45. In the fall of 45, and I was still in this my dream state of totally fearless and trusting that now everything is going to be wonderful. And everybody who was American, I trusted 100%, the Russians too, anybody. And I would go with autostop. I would, sleep someplace, and then I would see a jeep come by. They would pick me up, and they would say, "Well, I can take you to the next town, but there you have to fend for yourself." But they would bring me to the town square and say, "You can go in here and ask there and whatever." And that's what I did. And that's everybody was white or black. I didn't know the difference anyway. But everybody was very nice to me, and. I remember getting to Czechoslovakia to Pilsen, where they said that from here on things will be different because from here on it's the Russian zone. So from there on there were no more rides in jeeps, but I got on trains which were full of Russian soldiers, jammed with Russian soldiers. And they said, "Okay, don't worry, you can lie down and then sleep, and we'll watch over you." And I laid down and slept, and they watched over me. And that's how I went back to Hungary. I had nothing but help from all these soldiers, American, Russian, anybody, and kindness.
Right.
And then I arrived to Budapest. I went to Budapest. I went to what used to be my grandmother's apartment. And I just don't remember how my mother had two brothers in Budapest, and one was at that apartment with his fiance, who wasn't very happy, it's kind of I sort of suddenly arrived no place, and they somehow notified my father, and he came. This is a very, very painful thing. You know, actually, my psychological trouble started after all this. You know, until then, it was just, I was going through all this thinking that somehow everything will be back the way it was, and probably I'll go back to Debrecen, and then they'll carry me on their shoulder, be a hero, and then I go back to school, and, all that. And my father, who loved me so much, or who I loved so much, and who, could take care of everything and all that, and he came and saw me, and I was worried, what am I going to tell him? I would never want to tell him anything I knew that would make him very sad. I never saw my father very sad or show it. And he said, "What happened to you?" Like, he touched my face. "How I happened to you? Because it looks swollen." And I said, "No, it's not swollen. It's just I'm fat." I got to my face from all that peanut butter and everything. And it was not just fat. It was then the doctor said it was water also. Like, I suddenly started to eat so much, which happened to many people, that they ate so much, older people, and they died. It was very common, but nobody told that to us, that don't eat. They let us, and we were young, and we just put on weight there. And it was a water retention, I had like this. And then he said, "Where is Mom and little Peter?" And I said, "I don't know." I don't know. Like, he really knew more than that, but I just couldn't say. And then he said, "Well, where did they go?" or something. Well, and he said something like that, "Why did you let them?" or something to that extent. And I thought I'd go back, and I thought I will be, living with my father, and we'll go back to our old apartment or whatever. And he never, ever, ever lived with me after that. Never. And he sent me to back to Debrecen for a while with the This is my mother's cousin, who was her friend, whose husband also got killed. And he gave our apartment to her. She lived there with her son and me for a while. I went back to school. It was like a short semester so I could finish that year and then high school. And then I would come back to Budapest. Then he said, "I'll introduce you to a nice girl and her mother." And then he did, and then he said, "Well, they have room, and why don't you stay with them?" So I was always coming and going like that until that. And then I heard from some people that, you know, he was just a broken man. He didn't really show it outside, but he never wanted an apartment. He never wanted a regular life anymore. And he was very good looking, and he became successful even after the war, right after the war. And there were all kinds of young women around him. And they always told me, though, that he had enlarged the last picture of my mother. I remember this photo because we had it taken maybe a couple of months before all this happened, in early 1944, because we wanted to send this picture to my father, and I had my head on my mother's shoulder, and he had my head taken off, retouched the photo a lot, so that was a large photo of my mother, which I happened to have. And that was always next in his room, next to his bed. And they said he used to go to playgrounds to look at little children and things. And I could never, ever tell anything to my father because I didn't want to see him cry or something. And he never asked me anything. And then when I left Hungary in 1956 and I had my two little children, well, I started to see him. Yeah. I got married in 1950. January, and you want to know who my husband was?
First husband's name? Yes.
He was, his last name was Asztalos, Sándor Asztalos, Asztalos, and he was a writer, a poet, a musicologist, a true genius. He was, he really was a genius, and he just was too much of a genius for his own good. He just didn't have the character to carry this incredible package up there. And he was 9 years older than I was, yet he was a professor at the Debrecen University comparative literature, and he was the cultural commissar in Debrecen. And right after we married, we went to Budapest, where he became the head of everything that had to do with culture in the ministry, you know, with theater and opera and ballet and everything. And he was writing at the same time.
Was he Jewish?
No, I wasn't Jewish. There was one thing about my generation after the war. We were, I don't know what we would call some kind of a lost generation. This is the way the kids who came back, you know, who many of us never came back, many of our best friends, but not just our friends didn't come back, but their parents or grandparents or aunts or uncles. There is nobody in this world. I'm here to talk about my family, but there's no one to talk about their family. Entire families vanished. And we would meet, you know, boys and girls, and they say, "Well, what are you doing tomorrow?" And I'll say, or he'll say, "Oh, I think I'm going to Argentina. If you want to come, we're meeting at 6 o'clock on Budo and don't know what at this place. And you want to come, we'll go first to Italy and then by boat to Argentina." And I would say, "Oh, maybe, that sounds great." And I probably wanted to go, but I overslept or something like that. And this is the way we went. And it didn't matter who was Jewish and who was not Jewish. We just didn't want to hear about war and differences and hostilities or anything like that.
Now, you had two children at this time.
And I had, my son was born in 52 and my daughter in 53.
Your son's name?
Well, his Hungarian name was Gabor, and he changed his name to, in France, to Gabriel, in America to Gary. Mm-hmm.
And your daughter?
My daughter was Anna in Hungarian and became Anne and in France and Anne in America.
Fine. And Alex, what happened after Budapest?
So it was a very, very, very difficult, turbulent marriage because he was a very self-destructive and tortured genius. And to all this greatly added that this was the worst days of Stalinism in Hungary. So here is this incredible talent writing fantastic poetry, and they keep telling him and novels, and they keep telling him that this is expressionist and that's surrealist, and that is, you know, I mean, those were labels that they were tantamount to say that you should you should go to jail or go to Siberia. I mean, this was an anti-class action. So to somebody, to a creative person, to say all the time, well, take this name out and you have to put in there something about Tito, you know, that he is the unchained dog of imperialists or something like that. It really, really drove him crazy, even crazier. And he was an alcoholic, and it was just a horrendous thing.
How are you taking all of this after all you went through?
It was like a continuation of the whole thing. Plus that I admired him very much, and I saw him suffer, and it was just, and I was, he was from the right background besides, you know, he was like a self-made man because of who he was, but he came from a very modest background, and I was the capitalist background, so I didn't dare to open my mouth anyway, you know, because I was a class alien. So everybody was scared in those days in Hungary. These were the worst days of Stalinism. We who went through the days of the years of Nazism, we knew that no matter how bad it is, it's not as bad as that was. I mean, even in harder our differences, but it was horrendous. It was just the fear, the lying, that was the worst part. That was the worst part, that you had to lie to your own child, and you didn't dare to. You were afraid you would speak in your dream, because actually the expression that the walls have ears were true. And so we just lived. Another thing for the Jews who went back to their homeland, which was Stalinist Russian satellite countries, Soviet satellite countries, was an added thing, because you went home and you were not allowed to talk about what you went through. You were not allowed. It was like they made you ashamed of what you went through. If you would say something that, well, in my case, when I went back and I saw what's happening, at one point I wanted to go back to Germany, to this American camp, and I got as far as Slovakia, where they put me into a camp because I was Hungarian. You know, suddenly I was Hungarian there. And then they let me out. And I went back to Budapest. I saw I cannot go further than that. So when I was working in Budapest under communism, somebody reported me, which was the order of the day. Everybody reported everybody else anonymously. You never found out who said why, and, you know, just it is. Terrible things happened, that I was going to leave. I left the country for imperialist states. Of course, we had to write autobiographies all the time. And so they compared one thing to the other, where you had to say not just who you are, where were you born, but what was your mother and your grandmother and great-grandfather's profession. They were digging that, what was your origin. And if you weren't from working class or maybe peasant class, then you plenty trouble. So I didn't put this in my autobiography, that I one time went out as far as Slovakia and turned right back like a week later, and somebody reported me. And I used that when there was a trial. There was a party trial, you know, I was standing there like, I don't know, like Dreyfus. And I said, well, it's because, you know, I was a young girl and I came back alone and I saw there was no one there and I thought I'll go back. And then they started to holler at me, well, you're trying to make people feel sorry for you. And, we, you know, just I realized you weren't allowed to even say that.
We're going to stop the tape.
Okay.
Thank you.
Tape 5, Interview with Aniko Friedberg, Interviewer Tina Tito, December 14th, 1945. 95. We were interrupted at the trial in Budapest. Continue, please, with what happened at your
trial. My trial?
Yes.
Well, that was just a lesson for me that stuck for the rest of my life in Hungary, that you're not supposed to say this because it's not taken the way you give it. And the background for this is, of course, the anti-Semitism that permeated the Stalinist communism. You probably remember also, you know, the Jewish doctors' trials. It was horrendous. We all knew that these are trumped-up charges and far-fetched, but it started in Russia, and then it came in the Soviet Union, then it was coming toward Hungary also. So, of course, communism is really like a religion and doesn't tolerate any other religion, but least of all it tolerated Jewishness. So we were not supposed to say anything about that ever.
So your life continued this way, in this state of fear.
Yes. So which also adds another dimension of what we went through, Hungarian Jews or Czech Jews or Polish Jews who went back for one reason or the other. Because those who came to the United States or to France or Switzerland or to a free Western style democracy, were able to pick up the pieces and make a life for themselves. But like we went from one thing into the other, one terrible thing into the other. We had to live a life for so many years. So anyway, I was in this marriage, and I just knew that this cannot last. There's something. I have to find some kind of a solution. And in the summer of 1956, I decided to get a divorce because the children were 2 and 3, and I just didn't want them to grow up and to be old enough to hear this man who would come home at the wee hours of the night and go into a rage and break furniture and want to jump out the window and go to jump in the Danube, and this went on all the time. So I got a divorce. And which didn't quite end it, because he kept coming back and saying that he will change and all that. So in 1956, October, which was 2 months after my divorce, the Hungarian Revolution broke out. I did have some part in the revolution because I used to go to these clandestine meetings. I wasn't an anti-communist, I was an anti-Stalinist, an anti-totalitarian form of communism. And I certainly wasn't for imperialism or the country being run over by any other superpower. I just had enough of all this, and I wanted justice, and I was going to these meetings. I didn't do anything more heroic than that, but that's what everybody did who was in my situation, until suddenly the atmosphere was such that it was really enough to lit that legendary match and the whole thing would explode. And that's what happened. Nobody thought that anything could happen. Then when the Hungarian Revolution just erupted, and the children were by the divorce process given to me anyway. So I grabbed the 2 children, I went out, and I left the country, went to Yugoslavia. And it wasn't hard, because during those week or 10 days, the borders were open, everybody was going in every direction. It was, in many ways, it was a beautiful revolution, because the Hungary was united to one man. It didn't last because everybody's motives were very different, but the goal was the same. So it was a very exceptional feeling. So I went to Yugoslavia and I stayed in Belgrade for a while, and I asked for a French visa. because I had, my mother had a brother in France who I barely knew because he was only visiting once in Hungary when I was very young. And my mother used to go there, but I haven't. So that's why I nothing really happened with this uncle. I really was barely in touch with him, but that's why I went to France. And I lived in France until 1961 when I came to America and I worked in France.
Let me ask you a question. Here in Hungary, when you saw the opportunity, you realized you could leave.
Yes.
Let's parallel that back to your time in Germany under the Nazis, where you did leave and ran into the woods in the last minute. Were there any other opportunities during that whole time during the Holocaust where you felt you could leave? There was a way to get out?
Absolutely not. Absolutely not. In Auschwitz was in the middle of nowhere in Poland. We didn't even know where it was at that point, surrounded by barbed wires, electrified barbed wires, and besides, in no time we didn't have even strength to move from one point to the other. So it's just, this was too well planned for too long of a time. You know, it would take another couple of hours or maybe a day to just think of it, that how well, this was a very civilized, highly industrialized nation, and how they put all that know-how into, for years, how many architects and scientists and who knows what qualified, learned people worked on the perfection of such a machinery of killing off a whole race. So you can imagine that they thought of that, that nobody can get out of there alive. No way. No way, no how.
But yet within that system, I think there were so many moments where so many of the people, the captives, the Jews, were so creative, were so clever in surviving.
Well, I'm glad you say that, because not in Auschwitz, not where I was. There was no room for that. But in the German factory, I think back of that sometimes, and I wish I could write, because I would like to write just a short book on that. We used to put on shows even there, because the Germans wanted us, when they found out there was somebody there who was a wonderful violinist, and there were a few who had beautiful voices, there was somebody who could play the piano very well, there were some girls who were great at acrobatics and ballet. With a girlfriend, I used to put up. We used to put up shows like we were. I remember they were so funny. We were Anthony and Cleopatra with some kind of a sheet. Of course, we kind of took liberties with Shakespeare, you know. But the Germans didn't understand that anyway, and we made the scenery out of nothing. The poison that we had to fill the grenades and bombs with came in tall papers, double thick paper bags. When the paper bags emptied, this is why we didn't freeze to death. Then we somehow cut up, we didn't have scissors, I don't remember how, but we cut up shapes and we put it in these wooden shoes. I learned there how paper can keep you warm. What a wonderful insulating material it is. And from the top, they used to pull out the string, and it was several layers of string. And they started to knit from it, and they were knitting little knee warmers and little socks and making very nice things that the Germans started to like also, the women who guarded us, the SS women. That's an interesting thing that when I went to this reunion, and they introduced me to one of the girls I was going to grade school with, but we didn't recognize each other. And we asked the question from each other that everybody else asked, that where did you work? In grenades or bombs or upstairs or downstairs? So I asked the same question. She says, oh, I was in an Außenkommando. I said, Außenkommando, what's that? She said, well, we used to go out to dig. I said, I didn't even know that anybody ever went out to dig. I thought everybody worked in the factories. She says, no, you remember that, because I remember we were going back and forth that yes, no, yes, no. And she says, no, I know you did, because I remember I was coming back one day and I said it was so hard, because the earth is so hard to dig into, because it's full of something like clay. And you said, Clay, and could you bring me some? And I brought you some, and you were working this. And I had no recollection. And then it came back because others also said, yes, don't you remember it was my birthday and I was crying for my dad, the piano, and you made me a little piano. And then I started to remember that the German women kept asking me to make a little dog and a cat and a this and a that, and they would give us a half a potato or something for it. So I was doing that. I was doing this clay sculpture there. And then once I was in the Lagerspital because a grenade fell on my foot and broke it. And I was lying between two girls who were in much worse shape than I was. These were these very cadaverous little things that couldn't even get out of bed. But one of them could speak. She was a very wonderful, lovely young woman. I think she must have been maybe 20 or 21, and she was a teacher. And she knew a lot of poems, and she knew some poets I didn't know, and she was telling me the poems, and I learned them. And I was telling her what I knew, and she learned. So and this was not just between her and me, but this was something we did. We were telling poetry to each other, and we were, you know, we just kept so in touch with our culture and the things we used to do.
Wonderful. Let's go back now. You're in Paris with two little children.
So I'm in Paris with two little children, yeah. And I speak French, but with a heavy Hungarian accent and not as fluently as I learned a year or so later, but it was good enough to make myself understood. And I never, ever, ever thought of going to any organization. It just didn't even occur to me. But I got it. First, I entered. I heard that if you're a student, because this was a very young emigration, after the revolution, these were mostly students and young people. So that if you're a student, you can go and enter any French university, and you will get a stipend or a scholarship. So I wasn't a student anymore, but I decided I could be because I was still in my 20s. And they said, if you're under 30. And so I went to the École des Beaux-Arts, the Académie des Beaux-Arts, Fine Arts Academy, and I had to take an entrance exam, which I passed, and I got a scholarship. And I took advantage of all this incredible things that France offers to its citizens and not citizens, inhabitants, ever since the French Revolution. And so I lived, of course, I didn't have to pay tuition. I got a scholarship. I got a place to live in a cité universitaire. And I could eat there at the cafeteria. And I still had plenty of time left. I was accepted to the last year of the academy, and it was an atelier class, so it was okay if I just went once or twice a week. So I had a full-time job, at least one, if not two, all the time. Also, I was working for a perfume house. I learned the French perfume business inside out, which was good because that's how I got to America. Revlon hired me as their French perfume expert.
You also did some modeling?
And then on the side, I did modeling for L'Oreal. I was a model for hairdressers when they had shows, which also paid nicely because my hair looked very good all the time. And that was more like an evening job. Then for a year, I had a terrible evening night job. In addition, I was selling programs at the Bal du Moulin Rouge, you know, the famous Moulin Rouge. I had to stand outside with a stack of programs, and, you know, but that was also very lucrative. So I was making really as much money as a woman can in France without any help on an honest way. And I could never, ever have the slightest hope to have an apartment of my own. I had one small room, and my children were going to a school called Auberge, Œuvre Protection, pour les enfants juifs. It's a Jewish welfare organization. Was a wonderful establishment. There were still plenty of children from orphaned or coming from North Africa from the wars, and they were very devoted, dedicated professionals, loving professionals, and so that's where they were. They weren't with me, only on weekends in Paris. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to have an apartment and live with them. And so I was happy when this opening came, and I came out in 61. I got a one round-trip ticket for myself while I was on a vacation from my job there to see if I like it. And I came to New York, and I liked it because what Revlon offered me for 1 month was what I would make in France for 1 year, and I could immediately rent an apartment. So I took my round-trip tickets and the ticket that with which I would have gone back, I changed it for 2 half-price tickets because the children could fly half-price, and they came and joined me.
You got here in 1961.
In 1961. And then we started a new life, and I got an apartment in Forest Hills, and the children went to the public school across the street from my apartment practically. That's why I got this apartment. Of course, in those days, you didn't even have to worry about locking your door. They were like latchkey kids. They had both the key around their neck. And in the morning, either I would take them to school or they would walk me to the corner bus stop where I would to go into Manhattan. And we were incredibly happy. I mean, it was a big, big event. We would go and buy a vacuum cleaner and we would dance around, you know, and things like that. So, and then in 63, I met my husband, and in 63, I remarried.
And his full name, please? Your husband's full name?
Alan Friedberg. That's why I am Aniko Friedberg. And my first husband, by the way, a few years later died. And so my husband adopted the children.
Did you move to this area right away?
And we moved right away to this house. And this is the only house I ever lived in, and for definitely the longest time. And the children knew Hungarian when I went to France already. And they forgot Hungarian in France in no time. And so I wanted to make sure that the same thing doesn't happen when I come here. So when in America, I kept talking French to them. So they were both bilingual. And so when my son graduated high school, college here, he went back to Paris and he became to medical school where you don't have to pay anything for university. And so he became a doctor and he came back to America. And my daughter went to school also for a year in Europe after graduation, and she also came back, and they both live in Fort Lauderdale. So my son is a doctor, and my daughter is a stockbroker with a degree in psychology, but that's stockbroker. Mm-hmm. And I have one wonderful grandson, Alexander, who is 8.
And who are you? Are you Hungarian? Are you American?
I guess I am everything, because I want to be everything, but I'm so Hungarian it's almost painful, because it is a very, very strong culture, and I was born into it, and I it's a beautiful language, and I love the language. I just understand it like I will never understand any other language, and I was just back there visiting, which I seldom do, and I found myself reading so much more than I, mean real reading, like novels, not just news stories and magazines, and enjoying it so much more than I thought. I lost that enjoyment of literature like I did there, but it's because the language and the music and the poetry and just it's bigger than me. It's just there.
Please tell us about what you do today, your profession.
I'm a professional sculptor. I started seriously stone sculpting in 1963 when I moved into this house. And stone and wood, direct carving. And I also teach both privately and for the Huntington Township Art League. And I have shows, and I hope to live a long time, because I feel I have so much to make up for, and I want to do so much more, and I have plans, and I'm grateful that I was able to do at this age so much in the last 10 years especially.
Is your sculpture particularly Judaic?
No, not at all. I don't think so. It's not particularly anything, because all through this political and racial and economical and personal upheaval, I always hung on to what I felt was the most important to me, like the beauty of the human spirit and the joy, and that's what keeps giving a coherence to my everyday life. Some people, of course, look at my sculpture and they say that they can see where I come from. So maybe there is something there. I have done some work. Like last year, I made this outdoor Tree of Life menorah for this congregation on Long Island. And I have one Holocaust-style subject sculpture at the Holocaust Center here in Nassau, at the Nassau County Museum. And I have one plan, just one plan that I have for a Holocaust memorial that I have made a small maquette, but I haven't translated into anything bigger. Maybe one day I will, which is close to my heart other than that.
I know this is really the first time you've talked about your whole life. Why have you decided to do this tape?
The way the years go by, more and more I get almost like a panicky urgency to do something while I'm still here, because there are less and less survivors, and we just don't know if there will be any in 10 years or what. And in the face of all this distortion and revisionism, which is just plain lies, I just so much want to do my share of talking face to face to people, especially young people, and tell them my story, which is history, not my story, history, her story, bigger than my story, and while I tell it, maybe I will have one day an idea of what can we really do to avoid anything like this in the future.
Thank you for taking the time to share all this with us. Tape 6, interview with Aniko Friedman, interviewer Tina Tito, Friedberg, sorry. Interview with Tina Tito, December 14th, 1995. Would you please introduce your husband?
This is my husband, Alan Friedberg.
Mr. Friedberg, sorry for the mistake.
That's okay.
Is there something that you would like to say to us?
Well, during all of these interviews and conversations with Aniko, I keep thinking about, I had family in Europe also. My father had a brother and a sister who had family. I never knew any of them. These were my cousins, and they all said one day we knew that they had disappeared. And so this is, to me, kind of striking also, because it, of course, it hits home with Aniko, but it hits home also, it gets me back to many years ago in the late 1930s when I was aware that these things started to go on.
Thank you. Well, maybe that...
That was in Latvia, right?
Yes.
In Latvia.
In Latvia.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Well, thank you, and thank you for sharing your home with us and your experiences.
Thank you for coming.
Tell us who's in the picture.
This is my parents' wedding photo taken in Budapest, I guess in 1927.
And your mother's full name?
Ilona Benedek, my father, Ferenc, at that time, very wise.
Thank you. Tell us about this.
This happens to be the only picture I have from my young age. I must be 5 or 6 years old here in some kind of a ballet performance.
This was taken about 1933?
Probably.
In
Debrecen.
In Hungary.
Hungary.
Thank you. Tell us about this picture.
And this is the only picture I have left with my mother and father. I guess this must have been taken around 1933 or so in Debrecen.
Thank you. Tell us about the picture.
And this is that photo I mentioned earlier about my mother. My father, we had this taken together to send it to my father just a few months before we were taken away. On the right shoulder, you see that pale spot, that's where my head was.
Thank you.
But my father had it removed and enlarged, and he had it always next to his bed.
Thank you. Tell us about the picture.
Mm-hmm. This is my uncle Tibor Benedek in Paris, who is photographed with a friend of his, Miss Tangeci used to be very famous at one time, a friend of Chevalier's, a singer, dancer.
And because of him?
And that's why I went to Paris, and my mother knew also Miss Tangeci, and she used to go to Paris and visit and stay at her house by Versailles.
Thank you. Please explain this picture.
This is my father in a coal mine when his invention was introduced. This is under Stalinism in Hungary. It's called a hydraulically marching mine machine. And it's still used in Hungarian as well as all Russian coal mines.
About what year was this invented?
Oh, I must have been maybe 54, 55.
Fine. Thank you. Please tell us about the picture.
I mentioned earlier that Revlon, actually Charles Revson, who was the owner of Revlon, hired me to be the expert of the fragrance expert of Revlon. They were just going into the perfume business in New York, and this is why I stayed in America, and that was my first job. And this is they had a publicity picture made of me, and this is just a proof, an unretouched proof that they have given me.
So this is around 1961?
This is in 1961.
In New York?
In New York.
Thank you. Please tell us about
this. This is my daughter, Anne.
And when was this taken?
Well, it's a year ago, this summer, past summer.
And where?
She was right here in the back of, behind the house.
Here in
she
Huntington?
She was visiting here in Huntington, yeah. She lives in Fort Lauderdale.
Thank you. Go ahead.
This is my darling only grandson, Alexander. And this picture was taken about 3 weeks ago. He was just visiting and gave it to me. He's 8 years old.
And he's the son of?
And he's the son of my darling son, who, even though I cannot find a current picture of him, he's nothing to be ashamed of. He's a very good-looking and wonderful guy.
Thank you very much. Please tell us about this book.
Okay. So since that reunion in Germany I was telling you about, they erected a museum in this on the site of the old Dynamite Noble headquarters, which was a landmark building. And it really is a quite remarkable building. I was invited for the opening, and I was also commissioned to make the only sculpture there. And this is the catalog from that museum, which is called also a Documentation and Informational Center. And this is the catalog with a photo of my sculpture on the cover, which represents the slave laborers there, the way we were, like the two figures are like one is with a bowed head, humiliated, heavy labor carrying the grenade, and the other one is standing erect, looking upward and letting a bird fly off, representing freedom and our hope.
And this was in 1992, the museum opening?
I think it was in 93 or 94 even.
Here it says 1992.
That's when the sculpture was commissioned, but it was a landmark building. It took a long time to build it just so. So it wasn't inaugurated until 94.
And your name here, you use your...
Yeah, my professional name is Aniko Friedberg, which Aniko Friedberg is my maiden name, and Faye was added because of other things.
Fine. Please tell us about this article.
This is the January 16, 1995 edition of Newsweek magazine, which was an Auschwitz memorial edition that I happened to open by chance. And I found myself in this picture, which represents us, the part of the 1,000 Hungarian girls on our way from Auschwitz to this German factory. And I happened to be the tall girl right on the crease.
Thank you. Please tell us about this.
Okay. This is a homemade photograph of a maquette of the only Holocaust memorial that I ever designed. I always believe, just like I don't think that words can convey the inexplicable, the human tragedy that was the Holocaust, I feel the same way about the ability of visual arts to do that. But this I see as preferably larger than life size bronze of
obelisk?
No, it's a thin slab, like a slab, where the figure of a family would be cut out. So it's the void that it represents in the lives, in the hearts of the survivors as well. And this is a side view, obviously. And the other part of the sculpture is that it would have to be on a large bare terrain, so the way the sun moves or reflectors, it always casts a shadow where the figures emerge in light. And I feel simplicity is the strongest, and that's the only thing that I would hope to one day to execute.
Thank you very much.